I'm going to make a certain a series of what I think are factually supported assertions. If any of the assertions are incorrect, I want you to correct them, because you know, hypotheticals or realities are no good if there's an incorrect factual assertion. So it appears as if the female terrorist in California entered the United States in July of 2014 on a K visa. And there's an application process which includes some level of investigation on our end. And as I understand the application process, it may well be that USCIS and the State Department have some level of engagement, at least at the application process. And then, as I understand it, there is or is supposed to be an in-person interview at an embassy or a consulate, which is another level of investigation. So you have the application, which may involve USCIS and the State Department, then you have an in-person interview. And the way I count, that's at least two and maybe more levels of inquiry or investigation. And then we fast forward, the FBI director today, I believe, tells us that there is evidence that the female terrorist was radicalized 2 years ago. And there's a media account, and you are free to put whatever stock you would like in a media account, but it's been widely reported that the male terrorist was part of a plot in 2012 to do harm in this country. So it appears to me that the investigations done by our government would have occurred after both her radicalization and after his previous plot to commit an act of terror. And yet the visa was approved, and she immigrated here, and 14 body bags later, we are trying to figure out what went wrong. So, assume arguendo that the FBI is right. Which is not an unreasonable assumption. The female terrorist was radicalized well before her application to come to the United States. How did we miss that twice?
So again, I will take that question as a hypothetical, given my inability to speak to the specific factual scenario. I think in addition to the interviews that you described, individuals are also vetted against law enforcement and intelligence databases at multiple stages in the K-1 visa process. So when we adjudicate the petition by the U.S.-based person, usually the fiancé on our side of the ocean, there was a series of background checks done at that time. The State Department does another more fulsome series of checks, and then we see that individual then again at the time of adjustment once they are in the United States. The nature of the interview depends on what derogatory information we have about the individual. So in the absence of a specific bait, we ask a series of questions that obviously are intended to vet that individual out, but in the absence of a specific basis, we probe basically the record that is before us. One of the things that we are looking at right now, and again, I think about this not just in terms of the fiancé visa program, but I really think of it in terms of everything that we do, are there things that we need to be doing differently prospectively to probe even more deeply to ensure that we are not admitting individuals who will come here to do us harm?
I wholeheartedly concur that we should be looking at all visas, no matter what letter occurs in front of them. It just so happens that this is a K visa, but the analysis could very well be the same regardless of what kind of visa it was. And what I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, but what I hear you saying is we don't know if anything would have been done differently, and it's a thorough investigation, and yet we still missed it, which tells me that I have to go back to South Carolina and tell people there's just going to be an error rate.
Well, you know, one of the issues that we're looking at are what are our authorities at different points in the process. So, for example, at the point when we adjudicate the petition, as it stands right now, as long as the bona fides of the petition are established by the U.S.-based petitioner, regardless of what derogatory information may exist against that individual. We don't at that, and again, I'm talking generally. I'm not talking about this any specific case. That is certainly an issue we're looking at as to whether we need to think differently about what we do in that stage of the process. We're also looking at what we do on the back end of the process, at the time when we actually give that person a green card, or we give them a conditional green card. Are there additional measures we need to be taking at that stage as well?
Director, do you know whether or not the female terrorist in California was interviewed in person at an embassy or a consular post?
Again, respectfully, Chairman, I am not at liberty in this setting to talk about any specific. Now, I can tell you what our practice is. Generally, there have been exceptions to this. Generally, it is our protocol that we do not, we only interview people in the K-1 visa program in cases where there is some issue that needs to be explored as part of the case. That could be derogatory information about the individual. It could be factual questions, not necessarily derogatory about the application. That is the existing practice as we speak. That's certainly going to be part of our review.
Do you know how long the investigation lasted from the time she applied for a K visa until the time she was interviewed at whatever consular post or embassy?
Again, I am not at liberty to discuss a particular case. That can be from the time they get in. If I'm understanding the question, from the time they're interviewed at the consular post to the time that we adjust them, is that the question, sir?
I was more interested in from the time she applied until the time there was whatever first interview, whether or not there was research done into her school, if any, attended, social media, if any, employment history, if any. And I'm out of time, so I'm going to go to the general lady, and I'll give her exactly the same amount of time I took. I'll just tell you this. I appreciate, because I hear it a lot from administration folks, that they cannot discuss an ongoing investigation. I would just note the obvious. They're dead. So I don't know that we're terribly worried about their privacy considerations. And I'm not lodging this allegation at you specifically. I can just tell you, I've been around 5 years now, and it just strikes me that sometimes folks cite an ongoing investigation or prosecution when they just really would prefer not to answer the question, because there's not going to be a prosecution of either one of these terrorists. You and I agree on that. So I'm not sure what we're worried about jeopardizing by allowing Congress to look at her file. What investigative or prosecutorial strategy would be jeopardized by allowing Ms. Lofgren and I to look at her immigration file?
Again, I'm really citing the general practices and rules. I mean, I think you and I are both aware of cases where, in fact, regardless of the fact that there may be two dead perpetrators, where there are still actually investigative reasons to maintain secrecy. I'm not speaking necessarily to this specific case. That is the practice that I have lived by, be it in my role as USCIS director or when I was a prosecutor previously, that I did not talk about cases that were ongoing, regardless of those characteristics. I understand why this body would want them. I understand why that information might be helpful to this body in discharging its responsibilities. I do not see myself as at liberty to share that information at this time.